Dan, it's nice to meet you again.
Yeah, you too.
It would be better in person.
It'll be nice. We'll get back to that.
Yeah.
All right, I think I'll get started here, okay?
Okay.
So, welcome back, everyone. And I want to reiterate Jerry's comments earlier. We really appreciate all the great speakers for sharing their time with us this week. And I'm especially pleased that our next keynote speaker was able to join us today. Teresa has done fantastic work on retirement for many years and has been very influential in how we think about retirement challenges, including for myself. So we've asked her today to share her thoughts on the challenge of annuitization. While some of us may prefer pensions over individual-based accounts that leave workers with a lump sum and a lot of questions, there are large number of people in this situation. So I believe it's incumbent upon us to take the challenge seriously. And we talk a lot about the challenge of preparing for retirement, but post-retirement risk can be even more daunting. On an individual basis, needs will vary a lot based on events outside of one's control. And this is something we looked at in our Growing Burden report last year. For instance, if you think of longevity, 10% of 65-year-old women will live for less than 9 years, but another 10% will live more than 33 years. So that's a wide range of possibilities to plan for. And another variable is changing interest rates, and that impacts how much income you can create with your lump sum. I'm sure people beginning their careers in the 80s were not expecting today's 10-year treasury rates. And on the cost side, we have things like health and long-term care, which can be significant and come late in life. And the broader economy as well, you could be approaching retirement when a recession hits. It could mean losing your job and seeing your savings hit. In the Growing Burden, we noted that one person may own a home, retire at a good moment in time, live for only 4 or 5 years in retirement, and never face long-term care costs. But their neighbor may be forced to retire earlier than planned, live another 40 years, and face hundreds of thousands of dollars of costs in their 80s for long-term care after years of rent increases. So, I think that summarizes some of these challenges a little bit. But Teresa, thank you again for joining us. And I look forward to hearing more of your thoughts on this issue
Yeah.
as it's getting more attention.
Dan, one of the reasons I'm so glad to be working with you is that that report was fantastic. I learned a lot. And not enough people in the retirement community for the past 40 years has really concentrated on that de-accumulation phase. Accumulation has been on our minds because half the people in the country who are working don't have access to a retirement plan. And policies, especially tax policies, are really oriented towards people at the very high income. We also know that people make lots of mistakes and give bad advice and are predated on the, in the investment stage. So the accumulation's a problem, the investment. But if you do those things right and you have $1 million or $100,000 when you retire, no one's really had a good solution in this country for what to do with that. And I wanted to share today what economists are thinking about that problem, that de-accumulation problem. And let me just show you a few slides that will, I think, will really, sorry about this. Well, I will just share it right now. Okay. We'll actually just show you how economists are thinking about this. So I'm going to show you a slide with too many words on it, but don't be dissuaded. Here we go. One thing that economists have done is reject this idea that people are stupid for not buying annuities. We know from surveys that people want annuities. We know from surveys that people aren't aiming to be rich and use that money to get more money in retirement, people aren't really even oriented towards bequests. They want to know that they might be able to leave a little bit for their adult children and their grandchildren when they die, but they're more interested in being able to give gifts or see their family before they die, or be independent of their adult children before they die. Those are those goals. And so annuities are perfect fits, you know, for those needs. So economists know that some of the demand for secure lifetime income is not matched by the supply of ways to get secure income. Economists also know that the private sector offerings for annuities or for secure incomes are inherently going to fail. It doesn't really make sense for an individual to go out and insure themselves for their health insurance because of adverse selection. And that is true also in annuities. Every insurer who offers a private annuity knows that those who have private information that they'll live longer are going to be the ones that seek an annuity, and they have to price that. So anybody who just wants a guarantee will have to pay that extra adverse selection surcharge. And they also have to pay that extra surcharge of profits for that insurance company. Most every insurance company has shareholders who need to be fed. And so adding that adverse selection surcharge because there's no pooling, and adding that for-profit premium to that annuity makes the product really inappropriate for most people. Economists are beginning to realize, along with experts and even people in the industry, that the best annuity for American workers is to delay claiming Social Security, to get a Social Security benefit that's as large as it can be. And that makes sense, as I'll talk about, even for people who are groups that have average low mortality. So there is this consensus agreement, and I'm providing evidence from the debate in the Bipartisan Policy Center Commission on Retirement Security, of which I was a member. Those 2-year deliberations, looking at all the data, that helping people delay claiming Social Security could be the best way to get people who want an annuity, extra annuity, to get the annuity that they need. So if economists are worried about this gap in the market between demand and supply, the answer is a higher Social Security benefit. We all know that if you claim later, you don't claim at 62, but you wait until 70, that your Social Security benefit will be, depending upon your situation, more than 35% higher. If you have dependents, the value of that extra monthly benefit is quite valuable. It's not actuarially neutral because having a guaranteed benefit for life, having that extra longevity insurance is, in terms of what economists say, adds to extra utility. So almost everybody, except someone who has just been diagnosed with a fatal disease and have no dependents, almost everybody benefits from a delayed claim age. And so what I hope is that economists and policymakers can really work creatively in the next 4 years to create ways for more people to be able to bridge to a higher Social Security claim age. We also know, and this I think was echoed in your report, Dan, the NERS report, that there's some really interesting research coming from the Health and Retirement Survey, that's big panel survey that comes out of the University of Michigan, that combines wealth with health to show that with everything else held constant, someone with $500,000 worth of present value of annuities, comparing that with someone with just $500,000 to manage on their own into their 60s, 70s, and 90s, that the person with the annuity is much better off in terms of mental health, that we are understanding that giving the responsibility of managing lumps of money when they're going into their time of life, where cognitive decline is not just a risk, but is expected, is sort of like having national policy where we put $10,000 bills pinned to the lapel of a 70-year-old, send them on the bus and tell them to be careful. It really doesn't make sense to structure an entire society around having people in their 80s having to solve one of the most complex problems, a financial problem a household could have, how to make money last for an entire lifetime and maintain your living standards. So annuities, and there has to be more research in this area, but the data is there, reduces anxiety, cortisol levels among the elderly. In fact, annuities can help boost mortality and improve health. And I'm thinking lump sums probably have the opposite effect. In the short time that I have available, I want to share with you some really important wealth data that I collected for the U.S. Senate's Committee on Banking just a few weeks ago. This was data that Senator Sherrod Brown asked me to bring to the committee. My research team at the New School for Social Research helped put this together. And it's an updated data of what Ed Wolf used to do using the Health and Retirement Survey. The 2018 data, the most recent, has just come out. We weren't able to clean it for this, but wealth doesn't change. But I want to draw your attention to a couple of things I've done with data that might be familiar with you. First of all, let's look at the category. For people who are 52 and over, which is really the time to look at wealth, we have categorized it as the wealth that is held in your primary residence, in your car, and other kind of real estate that you would have net of the debt you have, your car loan or your mortgage. We also look at the value, the present value of your promised Social Security benefits. We look at the wealth you have in your retirement savings, and not just in your 401k, but also what the present value of your DB pension would be. We look at the stocks and bonds you might be holding outside of your retirement accounts. And so that's the list of wealth. What's novel here is to display the wealth of Social Security alongside of your other forms of wealth. I haven't included Medicare. That's an insurance policy that's distributed according to how sick you are. There's no way I'm going to say that someone who has terminal cancer and is taking expensive drugs is somehow wealthier or better off than people who are well. So this is just wealth that you can draw upon to have a stream of income for the rest of your life. The other novel part of looking at wealth of Americans this way is the way I've divided up the categories. Here I'm following the research of Thomas Piketty and other wealth researchers who have looked at countries over time and across the globe and have come to the conclusion that in order to characterize the wealth and health of a society, you only need to look at what the bottom 50% of your population have, what the next 40% have, that kind of middle class and upper middle class, and what the people at the very top have, the top 10%. That quintiles or even decile examinations of wealth and income really don't show you the picture. So the novel part of this display of wealth for older Americans is by looking at the categories. And what I have concluded is what the NERS report concluded is that annuities are really only relevant for the top 50% of Americans. Selling annuities, creating annuity products really don't have any relevance for people, for half our population. So it's very important to bring up short those people who want to sell annuities and 401k products, that it can help about 28% of Americans, but it's not a broad-based solution to the retirement crisis. So here I'm making that point. If we're looking at how to annuitize wealth beyond Social Security, we're really talking about the top 40%, and we're really concentrating on the needs of the top 10%. Important people, but not the widespread solution to the retirement crisis that we need. I want to point out that annuities can also make sense for low mortality worker. So here's a low mortality worker. It's somebody who puts their head in the jaws of a live lion. A lot of people have jobs like this. The previous panel, especially Kate Bond, talked about people who are forced to face higher risks of death and morbidity when they go to work. But it turns out that even if you're a African-American man, because they have the lowest mortality of anybody at age 65, it might make sense for you to take your $25,000 or your $50,000, use that, and bridge to a higher claim age. So in closing, I want to talk about some bright spots. These are bright spots, not only because the solution is making sense among experts, but it's also the right time to propose these solutions as the retirement crisis kind of stays in the background to the infrastructure and COVID crisis, that we may be able to get a team together in the federal government to do some simple things. So one thing that the AARP did several years ago is to ask the community to come up with some creative solutions about how to solve the retirement crisis, especially for people in the bottom half of the income and wealth distribution. But again, this is very relevant for a good number of people in the middle class. One of the solutions that my research team, my co-author Mike Papadopoulos and Tony Webb, many of you might know Tony from his work, good work with Alicia Manel up in Boston, is that we proposed ways that people could buy extra Social Security credits. And these extra Social Security credits could also be used to buy bridge annuities. People might not have enough money to buy an annuity that will last them for 20 years, but $50,000 or $100,000 can get you an annuity that gives you decent income between the ages of 62 and 70. And then 70 is when you use up your $100,000, but you get a much higher inflation index monthly benefit from Social Security. I'm also working with a great group of people the last year, including Gene Sterley and Karen Smith, Larry Atkins, Harry Conway, Nita Issa, and John Rother, and Laura Kastensen from Stanford. We've been working for a whole year to think of ways to help the retirement crisis. And one of those ideas that's completely doable is that the Social Security Administration really changed the way they describe the Social Security claiming process. First of all, we propose that we dump this idea of early retirement penalty and a delayed retirement credit and just deliver the benefit information in a much simpler way. Your benefit is at its maximum at 70. And if you claim earlier, you have a lower monthly benefit. And just show someone a simple graph of how your benefit goes down. But as you do that, you also recognize that people are in great need of having money, by the time they reach 62, they're stuck in bad jobs. They have a lot of debt, and there should be very pointed ways to help people in their 60s maintain their level of income. It's quite a bright spot that the Congress has seen fit to raise the earned income tax credit to childless workers and to extend it to workers over 65, because we are seeing evidence that people are working at 62, their jobs are really low pay and insecure, and they're collecting Social Security on top of their work working earnings in order to give themselves a little boost. But they're using their Social Security to supplement low wages because they don't even have access to an earned income tax credit. So we're seeing that most workers, and I'm going to say this slowly and repeat it, most workers over age 62 claim Social Security. Social Security is not a retirement benefit. It's a boosting wages benefit. And so I hope that Congress makes the extension of EITC to childless workers who are low income and to workers over 65 who are low income permanent. That will help people not claim their Social Security early. I have also proposed a TSP for all proposal that would give low income workers some income. I hope that when you reach 65 as a low income worker, you won't have that much more income to last your whole life, but you will have income to delay collecting Social Security from 62 to even 64. And that can make a big difference. I'll stop here. There's a lot of information here. If you get my slides, I have footnoted almost all the claims that I have made in my presentation. And I look forward to your questions. And I have one in the chat, and it's a thank you. any other questions? Hi, Hank, Kim. Okay, so Hank asked me what I think about Biden's campaign's retirement policy to give a 401k tax deduction or a 401k tax credit. Hank, thanks for asking me about the candidate's retirement proposals. I think that Joe Biden had some of the thinnest retirement proposals. And some of this is brought over from the Obama-Biden administration, and that was to make the tax system much more fair. Ben Harris, who advised Biden, candidate Biden, is apoplectic, as I am, as many of us are, that the generous subsidies for retirement savings in this country, which is in the form of a tax deduction, goes disproportionately to people who are in the top 20 income group. Someone who saves the maximum, making way to give a incentive, a government match to low-income people. So to answer your question, Hank, it's a good start. Oh, I can't make any eye contacts with any of you great people. So any questions you might have, I have to see it in the chat. All right, it's time to wrap up. I look forward to seeing you all next year.